It's all good. Square this thing.
Yeah. I got mine.
Oh, 5:30. Let's call the Finance Committee to order. And we will hold just a moment while Mr. Kozier returns. I will start, Mr. Kozier doesn't need here to be here for this part. I will start by apologizing to you all. Because I did meet with Ms. DeGenova last week and said, no, it's getting to be that time. Why don't we look at Encumber and Plowing budget line?
Good timing.
So I take full responsibility.
So did everybody get one of those
things? Snowstorm today.
These are just extras?
It's completely my fault. So, regardless of today's weather, let's still look and see where we're at with the Plowing line so we can discuss it at a future meeting, perhaps.
All right, so just as a general overview of 2016, the budget that the city has. Its Plowing budget is $112,000. Zero has been expended as of today, but obviously that will change as soon as today comes to dose and tomorrow. Road salt is a budget of $310,000. Now, in that line, which is the 5142455 you see in your budget, that's salt and coal patch expenses. And road salt also is a source of revenue for the city. If others, such as the county, housing authority, and the school district, historically are the entities that we would store salt for and sell salt to, provide salt to. So for 2016, as I said, fine, but expenses have been zero. Road salt, we haven't had any expense because as late in 2015, we actually filled up the shed to its limit, I believe, Mr. Levine.
Yeah, as of today, we have an inventory of about 1,200 to 1,500 tons of salt.
So that's really, that's what you've got as far as if you wanted to estimate a portion of the Plowing and potential salt budget not to be expended. When we have our discussion that Ms. Barrazzo refers to, it was suggested if the city council wanted to go in a direction of locking up some funds that encumbering them and leaving them in the budget, but put them aside. Under a encumbrance where it could not go, funds could not go out the door unless it were opened up by either the mayor or the commissioner of finance or however you want to do it, because it's really not appropriate to take the money out of the budget and put it into a reserve. I'm not sure if there's anything else you want to
say. No questions. I just thought it was something we should start looking at. Obviously, we're going to have to revisit it because we're going to have some expenses coming in, but I can't imagine that we're not going to end up where they have to be served plus regardless. So I wanted to open up the conversation and then maybe we'll revisit in a couple of weeks.
Just a quick question. Do we have to cover into fall too with this?
Yes, you would have
to. No, next year, yeah.
Yeah.
Which is why if we did an encumbrance and left it in the budget,
yeah.
If fall were
just in
come,
case we get hit.
And give us a surprise as opposed to fall we just went through.
This goes through December, so so that is a consideration also. But the money would be there; it just wouldn't be like, oh, let's just take from this line because we have it here, kind of thing. Which we've done in the past when we've had, I think, my first year on the council, we had a very light winter and we ended up going that route. So, just opening the discussion, we'll revisit. Any other questions or comments?
Don't ask for it to be on the agenda till
no.
later in the season,
yeah.
though.
Yeah. No, we're safe. Yeah, there's no range. Yes. Anyway, thank you. And so we're on to the sewer fund 2016 budget reappropriation. Also, Ms. DeGenova.
Thank you. What's before you is a request to make a change to the sewer fund budget, and that change is to remove a position, which is a CSEA position, that's a entitled Payroll Attendance and Scheduling Clerk, and replace it with another CSEA position, which is an IPS 3. And the reason for this is the Payroll Attendance and Scheduling Clerk is a title that has been reviewed for quite some time, and that individual that had that title has recently retired, and it is not really reflective of the duties that have been performed and need to be performed. So we conferred with the union, who is aware that we're coming forward with this and supportive of it, to make this change to allow the city to move forward and address the work that needs to be done more appropriately. What I've done is put together a fiscal view of the budget that takes care of the payout that's due to this retiree and funds the IPS 3, assuming a start time somewhere in May. And what this actually does is it will give the city savings, or I should say, I don't like to use it with savings, reduced expenses into 2017 because of the different salary structures between the current position and the one that's being proposed.
Questions?
So this position is $42,000, is that correct?
Which one, the IPS 3?
Yes.
The IPS 3 is funded at a salary cap of 39.3.
39.3?
Right, but I've got it in here for sometime in May.
Okay.
So just really fine-tuning it this year and next year.
Will be 39.
Right, well, that would be the base for it.
Okay.
Depending on the contract.
Okay.
And that's the cap for it.
So this position that we're getting, that you're moving this away from this PAS clerk, was this a civil service position?
They both are still, yes, they are both civil service and they both are still CSEA positions.
So the position will still be there, we're just moving?
Well, the civil service will still have the job title, but it will not be funded in the city of Schenectady's budget.
Okay.
Instead of the payroll attendance and scheduling clerk, what will be funded in the Schenectady budget will be the information processing specialist.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Comments?
I'll move it.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and on to the council as board of contractors of apply regarding bid appeals.
I can speak to this one for Mr. Frank here.
No.
This is just passing a resolution to kind of codify the procedure that we already follow for when somebody wants to protest a bid award or a bid solicitation. The state has asked us to have a resolution just formalizing the process. And what it says, you see it on the second page here, it's the bottom paragraph, where if there's a bidder who wants to either protest the solicitation or the award of a contract, they just put it in writing and give it to the purchasing supervisor.
So I guess this is something we did not have in place prior to this. Is that what we're saying?
We haven't had a resolution that shows this is the city's official way of doing it, which is what the state wants to see.
Okay.
So what does the purchasing supervisor do with the grievance or the,
the protest?
I mean, it seems to me like someone else should be aware of the protest, right? If for it to really be...
Well, definitely. So the purchasing supervisor, for the policy, is supposed to take it and then they suspend the procurement pending resolution of it if warranted. So we'll sit down and have kind of an internal procedure where a number of different parties would be notified of it. We'd look into whether or not there is merit, whether it's the kind of thing where we have to stop a bid, change a bid spec, come back to the council and award a bid to someone else or something like that.
It just seems like there should be some sort of outside party that knows that there was a protest to the bid, not just the purchasing supervisor who didn't, necessarily support the bid to begin with. So I don't know. I just feel like there's not enough outside influence on it,
Check something.
Right, yeah.
Well, we can certainly do it however you'd like. We could put in there, whatever outside party you'd like to be made aware. You know, you can add a sentence or a paragraph or however much saying that, you know, if a protest comes in, XYZ party must be made aware, be it the council, the clerk, you know, the mayor, the governor. You go right up the ladder.
Yes, definitely, as the governor stepped in.
There you go.
Any input from the rest of the council on that?
No, it does make sense, so that it's just not it's not the same group that looked at it to begin with, because now someone has concerns, so you would need to have someone else.
Right.
Outside of that group, and someone who's unbiased, I don't want to say unbiased, but who's looking at it from another,
right,
through another lens to see, because maybe they'll see something in that the people that did the initial review did not see. So
is it wise
it
to have
sense.
It come before the council? We just try to think of an outside of the bid process entity, although we are part of the process, but
anything
think of a neutral party.
Well, when you're talking about a neutral party, you mean have a neutral party be the decision maker on it, or a neutral party just be made aware of it? Because once you have a contract award, once the council, you know, the board of contracts apply, awards a contract, if somebody wants to come in and protest it, this creates a formal procedure telling them kind of how to do it,
right,
but it doesn't create the legal mechanism for them to sue us. They still would have to go to court if we don't agree with their position. This is just kind of saying that if you have a problem, in lieu of having to go to court first, the city formally has this procedure where you come in, you give this to somebody, they review it, and you get a response.
Right, okay, so their next action would be to go to court if they're not pleased with what the purchasing manager does with their protest.
Correct.
Well, that seems fair enough. Okay. I mean, if there's another course of action, I'm looking for there to be another course of action rather than just filing a protest that gets ignored, possibly. Not that we would do that, but just trying to think all the way around the circumstances. I don't know if anybody else has any concern or anything to bring to that. I'm just, as long as there's another entity that can weigh it out, fine. Anyone else?
Well, yeah, I mean, I understand about they have the option to go to court, but wouldn't we like to see there be something that didn't necessarily get to that level, so there would be some other eyes that looked at it then before that, in between getting it and then, you know, asking for a review and saying, and us saying no, if that is what happened, and immediately going to court. It just seems like if there was that other entity, whoever that was, I don't know if that should be us or not, take a look at it. That to me makes sense. It wouldn't take us to the level of going to court, because I would hope that we would want to not have that happen as much as possible.
That's true.
I don't know what the other layer would be, but certainly I think it may be. Even if, so right now, is it the same group that always looks at all of the bids every single time, no matter which department it comes through?
I don't believe so, but I can't say for sure. I'm not.
Evaluate the bids, you mean?
Yes.
Well, the bids are opened publicly,
uh-huh,
and then they're evaluated by the department and requested the bid in conjunction with myself. So that if there was a problem with the contract, if there was an issue that someone came back,
uh-huh,
it would most certainly involve that department at a minimum, plus myself and probably the finance administration and probably the Corporation Council as well, to try and resolve that before it ever went to a lawsuit stage.
So the initial step, does the initial step include the Corporation Council and Finance? Does that initial step include them?
If one hiccup and came back? And
no. Before, if there was.
Well, the big documents that we put out hopefully cover everything so that we don't have to go to the Corporation Council with every single issue.
Mm-hmm.
But the Corporation Council does oversee the issuance of the contract. Make sure all the elements are there.
Mm-hmm.
And we have somebody at the bid openings as well. The law department does.
But ultimately what you're saying is the Corporation Council would be conferred with if there was a protest that came,
yeah,
in. And then you would legally look at it and say, no, we're fine legally, or no, we're not fine legally. Yes.
Yes.
So that seems, again, like a fail-safe method at that point.
Yeah, what we try to do is just take the language, we ask the state, you know, kind of what the bare bones that they were looking for in terms of the official policy is, and then we work out the internal policy on our own after to give us the flexibility.
Mm-hmm. And then is there any provision for a response to the protest, or?
We would certainly give a response to any protest.
Okay. Questions, others?
So we're looking for them to add that information in there, so we're going to hold off on this? Is that what we're talking about? Or
no, as long as we know Corporation Council is stepping in with the protest, which would be a normal process, correct?
Yes.
They're there at the even during the bid opening, is what he's saying. They're already there,
right,
in the initial process.
But they would also be looking for to making sure that. So that, I'm not sure Corporation Council is involved in the smaller details of choosing the bidder, right? Yes. So they're there to make sure the bids are open properly.
Right, and make sure too that the documents that should be there, bid bond. Performance bonds, et cetera, are in place before the contract is actually enacted. And then if there is a problem, I assume it would be at that point where a bidder might come back and say, well, I didn't get the event or whatever. Well, you have procedures for showing, you know, who the event was sent to, mm-hmm. you know, and then everyone had the same opportunity to address those issues.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's good. Okay. So I'm looking for a motion.
I'll move.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Is there any other business to come before the Finance Committee today? Ask for motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, Richard.
All right, I'll call to order the Committee on City Development and Planning. Some ceremonial resolutions. The first one is on autism awareness. Ms. Prazo?
Yep, just looking for a resolution recognizing autism awareness. I know the clock tower is being lit red, yellow, and blue in recognition also. And actually, we'll have a representative at the Monday council meeting to give us a small, short presentation as well. So.
All right, very good. Somebody want to move this? Ms. Porfield? John, second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Second ceremony resolution, Friends of the Library, 50th anniversary. Ms. Porfield.
As it states, the Friends of the Library is getting ready to celebrate their 50th anniversary. They have a gala coming up soon. So for all the work that they've done in the Schenectady County Public Library System, I'd like to be able to give them a resolution in recognition of that.
They do that at the gala, or are they going to come?
No, they would come actually to the
come
council.
Come to our meeting. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Any discussion?
Move
Ms. Moore. Second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Third ceremonial resolution to recognize Crime Victims Week. And Mr. Riggi, you have that one?
Yeah, it's something we do every year. Yep. National Crime Victims Week is April 10th through the 16th this year. And I believe the Rose Garden ceremony will be on the 13th, on Wednesday the 13th. Sort of fit right in with that. And we'll have representatives here, probably Pat and Jean will be here to accept.
All right, very good. We need a motion. Ms. Porterfield, Mr. Moldovan, second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. And now we come to Ms. Mancini. You've got the next two up here, young lady. Amendments to 2014-15 action plans with CDBG.
Of properties to continue with the Section 108 program has been doing,
which we're estimating that'll be probably about 10 additional properties, and then $75,000 towards a summer youth employment program, which was proposed for funds to use for 65 lower moderate income city youth to participate for 6 weeks in the summer youth employment program. So these are the amendments going forward to change both the 14 and the 15 plans. Once we go through the entirety of the process and you folks make any changes or other recommendations, it becomes adopted here. It then goes into a HUD as a kind of more of a guidance, and it becomes formally approved right then and there, so that these funds can be utilized probably in like the June 1st-ish area.
Any questions on this? Mr. Motivera?
Yes. So this is calling for a public hearing, so we don't need to do anything on this at this point in time. After the public hearing, we can get into more discussion. Well, that's the reason why I asked that question. I mean, I would like to see a little bit more funding towards the summer youth employment program. I mean, it's something that we've been advocating for many years, and finally we are actually putting funds towards the youth program. And, you know, the funds are available, so why not put a little more extra towards this program?
You suggesting, yes, Ms. Frazzo?
I have a question as to how this moves forward. So if we're funding the summer youth employment program or whatever way we're allocating these funds for 2014-15, how does this look as we move forward into 2016-17? Are we endangering any of our nonprofits and the funding stream they may receive or along those lines?
No, all of these funds are from previous year allocations. So
I understand.
Not affecting anything going from July 1st forward. So it's not endangering any other not-for-profit agencies of not getting funding that they otherwise would come forth and request through the 16-17 plan.
Okay, well, let me ask the question a different way then. What happens next summer with our summer youth employment plan, or the summer youth employment program? How do we replicate this chunk of money next year when summer comes? Is it a one-shot deal?
Right now it's a one-shot deal, but I would certainly, once we do budget talks and to Deborah, I really would like to see a line item established for summer youth employment. I think it's a very important piece to the entire city of Schenectady, and not taken away from the CDBG funds, but I'd certainly like to see it included into a line item for the city of Schenectady itself to fund this program. Because as Jackie said, these are funds that were not used for the last two years.
Right.
So you're certainly hoping we don't have $75,000 involved next year left over. But and again, I had approached the mayor actually asking regarding summer youth employment. Again, taking note of the CDBG hearings that we went to, that was one of the main topics, work for our teens. And I thought it'd be a great way. This would be in conjunction with SJTA, the Schenectady Job Training Agency. There's no admin at all. This funding would go straight to the youth themselves. So this year, you got to understand that the minimum wage went to $9 an hour. And the only thing that they do take out or that they add in this is FICA, which is, I believe it's 0.0765, am I correct? I think I'm pretty good with that number. So that's where we come up with that 65 youth that the $75,000 would cover. But I think we're asking to see, maybe we can round it up to 100, make it
yes,
even,
please.
Steven?
Yes.
And that would give us probably over 90 youth. I don't know how many. So I will go to Ms. Prazo first.
And where are you proposing that money gets moved from, Mr. McFerrin?
Well, we have two line items here. Street rehab or acquisition demolition. I want it's $25,000. We're just asking for additional $25,000.
I just personally feel like $75,000 is a big chunk of money, and we also, it's just as important to have our streets paved and have the bladed properties demolished. So I don't know. I'm one of seven, but I feel like what's being proposed is a generous allocation, and I agree with you that jobs for our youth are very, very important, but it's also $75,000, unaccounted for, so, it's a big plus as it is now, but again, that's just as much as my two cents.
Yeah. The numbers for summer youth last year, last two or three years, we've had well over 700 applicants. 90% of those teens reside in the city of Schenectady, and they all have to meet the TANF eligibility income guidelines, which is 200% of poverty. So, example, the family of four this year, the rate is their maximum household income cannot exceed $48,000. So that's pretty decent. But again, the majority of these kids that apply. And last year, the county was able to offer 350 jobs last year alone. And that was including a $100,000 grant that the Schenectady Foundation included last year. So without their help, we would have probably been less than 300 jobs for over 750 applicants. Again, for majority, large majority of city of Schenectady residents. Thank you, Ms. Porfield.
All right, so you've answered a part of my question. Last year you said there were over 300 jobs.
350.
Yes. And that's because the Schenectady Foundation gave additional funds?
Gave $100,000.
So do you, and you may not know the number right now, so do you know the prior year before they gave the grant towards that, do you know how many jobs there were?
Over 500. And the reason we did that was because it was a grant they received from the Schenectady City School District. That they were on the endangered list. And it was a very big grant that we had for 4 years. Mm-hmm. And again, the Schenectady School District, realizing that it was key for our kids to have jobs, put a large amount of money into that line item for summer use. So we did as many, I'm trying to think how far back it was, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, we had nearly 600 jobs that we had for youth. So the need is there, and the kids are there to work, and not kids, but the young men and women.
Yes.
But that was the biggest number we ever had was that. But again, the numbers have gone down because, again, the contribution from the state continues to drop as well.
And that grant is over with that?
We applied. SGTA did apply again this year. They're supposed to find out in April. They reapplied again for another $100,000 from the Schenectady Foundation. And of course, it's with Bob Crow. So again, the timeline, I believe, is somewhere in mid-April, end of April, is when they're supposed to find out. You were at the same meeting when he announced that, I thought.
But that wasn't the one I was asking about. You said there was a grant for the school system.
That was a federal grant.
So is that over with?
That's been over. Oh, yes, okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes, I'm sorry. Yes, that's been gone.
And this would be about 65 jobs, you're saying?
For this $75,000, yes. If you figure in the FICA, which again is our Social Security, so that I can retire someday, and maybe Vince as well, it comes to almost $77,000. But then they do some allocation for loss of jobs. Not every kid is going to work a full 20 hours a week for the 6 weeks. So there's some time that they, for loss, that the kids just call in sick or don't come to work, don't show up, essentially. Mm-hmm. But again, it's something I'd really like to propose down the line, you know, for next year's budget. I think it's very important that we continue to invest in our youth. And again, this is just one way that I thought we can do it, at least get a jump start. I'd really like to see if we come out of the street rehabilitation. But it'd be a very nice contribution. One shot for the kids. FTK. As Mike called it.
You know, come next year, we'll look at it from a different angle.
Yes.
Look at if we can allocate, you know, create the line item and continue to fund it if possible. Right. Since this money is available this year, that's, you know, because we had at the public hearing, there were outcry for youth employment. At the two public hearings, there were so much of speakers asking, what are we going to do for youth in Schenectady? And this is the opportunity we have in front of us here.
Right.
It's very big. I'm going to Calvary Tabernacle Church tomorrow, but that's where I attend, obviously. And we handed out over 55 applications to youth. And again, the majority of those kids, they reside in Steinmetz homes or McGaffin's homes, or right along Albany Street. And we're doing a workshop tomorrow with these kids. They're very, very excited about working. Many of them have never worked before. And I understand your point, you know, paving the streets and all that. I'm not going to argue that. But as I've always mentioned, I mean, to invest in our kids, it costs us over $300,000 a year to incarcerate a teenager for a full year. And we're talking about $100,000 here to invest into our kids, which will give us probably close to 80-some kids on the street, off the street. That's our cost. Yeah, our cost will be half of that. Yeah, go ahead.
I know that someone reached out to me, and I gave him your name, about something Albany does, and did you have an opportunity to speak with Linda regarding, because she was saying that she had been, Linda McFarlane from the Loan Fund, had been at one of the hearings.
McFarlane.
Okay, and she said that they had some ideas, so maybe it's an opportunity to discuss. Did she talk with you?
Mm-hmm.
You're shaking your head.
Yeah, I remember the leakage there.
Yeah, and so she had some ideas, because I guess Albany does, she just had some ideas that she thought maybe would be able to help us, because Albany seems to be doing a pretty good job about getting almost every youth.
That money is a line item that Mayor Jennings put in every single year. And of course, when Mayor Jennings left, this is on the camera, unfortunately, he left a $12.5 million deficit to the city of Albany. I don't know what that number is that they've allocated this year for summer youth, but that was a line item from the mayor's budget, strictly to summer youth employment. And I'm sure it's online. I can look online to see what that number was, or what it is now for this year, which
well,
is going to be significantly
different. She might be able to be of some kind
sure.
of help to us. And I gave her your name.
Okay.
To reach out.
Well,
to.
Make sure we try to connect again if you need that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'd be glad to follow up with her on that. But again, it's with SJTA, and they do a great job. Last year, they had over 135 businesses, local businesses, working with our kids. So I think I've rambled on here too much, but my apologies. We have a long day ahead of us,
yes.
too, as well, because we don't even have the other presentation, which is going to be more stuff. Is there any way we can support an additional 25, anybody? I mean, are we okay with that, or?
I mean, we can take it out of any one of the line items, street rehab, I mean, property demolition, we can leave it at 600,000, and 625 for street rehab, and the other 25,000 goes towards youth employment.
Towards the youth employment. Can we get a motion to change that? Or
I certainly believe in youth summer employment, but I think that we really need to make sure that we're trying to get as much done in terms of paving for our taxpayers, because I hear about employment, but I also hear about mm-hmm. that, can you come and pave? It's almost like, can you bring the truck to my street personally? So there's a lot about that as well.
Mm-hmm.
And we've had a relatively mild winter, and I think this may be the opportunity to catch up on some stuff that we haven't been able to. So I'm more inclined to kind of stay where it is, and if we do need another $25,000, to be looking at some of the businesses locally to see if they are willing to support the summer youth program, which helps the entire city. So because it's not, like you said, it's not a huge chunk of change, so if we could look at several businesses to support this effort, I think maybe we should think of a different way of getting that additional money.
Ms. Brown.
Well, and I also think part of the paving is ADA compliance, which I think is very, very important also. So to take money out of ADA compliance and say our summer youth employment is more important, you know, I mean, it's all important, right? It's all important.
Yeah.
And then I also see that as this is a huge chunk of money to receive without even knowing we're going to be able to offer it. So I think it's wonderful. I support it 100%. I agree on the jobs for our youth, but I think the way things are allocated makes sense to me. But again, I'm one of a group. So.
All right, so we got to have a public hearing on this. So obviously, okay. So let's do the public hearing.
I believe Mr.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was
okay. I didn't raise it.
Sorry.
I can't. I'm not waving today.
Go ahead, sir. Go ahead.
I think these things are all important, but it is a windfall, and I think the breakdown seems to be pretty fair. And, you know, we're not demoing a lot of houses with 600,000. Like I said, I think 10 is probably going to be it. So that's not a lot. So let's see what the public hearing, what the input is in the public hearing, but it is something that wasn't expected, so I call it a windfall. So.
All right, very good. So let's listen at the public hearing. Is that okay? And then it's got to come back to us again after that, I agree.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Let's see the final numbers.
The final adoption's on May 9th.
Okay.
And the notice on this goes in the paper on Wednesday.
And then we get the May 9th. Notice on this one as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Ms. Prazo.
I'm sorry. One more question. What departments was the money originally allocated to? I think that's also an important thing.
They were SNAP, code, and base program.
All right, so all we're doing is calling for the public hearing here, correct?
Yep.
All right, so I just need a motion for that. Ms. Porterfield?
Second.
Mr. Mosevier, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you much. And part two.
All right, so this is the longest. So for the 2016-2017 proposed annual action plan, this is the mayor's recommendation for all the funders that we received RFPs for a few weeks ago. So just as a recap, we are a participating jurisdiction, which means that we receive an annual allocation of an entitlement grant from the federal government in CDBG money, Home Investment Partnership Program monies, and the Emergency Solutions Grant Program. CDBG is kind of the overarching program, which is where we get the majority of our dollars from. The Home Investment Partnership Program is for homeowner renovation and certain kind of new construction and rehab type of things. And Emergency Solutions Grant Program is for homelessness and homelessness prevention services. So the annual action plan process outlines the proposed allocations being put forth for this upcoming federal fiscal year, which starts July 1st. And the allocations and the use of these funds are predicated on the national objectives that are set forth by the federal government, the first of which is to benefit low and moderate income persons. The second is to aid in the prevention or elimination of slums and blight. And the third is to meet community development needs at a particular urgency. We put forth for the 2015 through 2019 federal consolidated plan, the five-year plan last year. The general outcome of the city of Schenectady's neighborhoods are thriving, vibrant communities where residents and businesses are afforded viable opportunities to improve their quality of life. Under this, we have four goals that we ask every of the applicants to be able to put their project into one or more. The first is to meet the essential needs for food, shelter, and safety for every individual in the city. The second is to expand economic and employment opportunities and also increase the physical and economic mobility for all individuals in the city of Schenectady. The third is to improve and expand affordable housing options within the city. And the fourth is to strengthen the neighborhoods in the city of Schenectady. So here are our allocations based off of what we're anticipating to receive from the federal government this year. It's a little over $2 million for the community development block grant money, $185 for emergency solutions grant program, which went down by about $1,000 from last year, and home investment partnership program, which is $357, which actually went up by about $40,000 this year. So we're hopeful that that continues for a grand total of $2.6 million. I just wanted to show the difference in funding, because I think this is how the trend is going to continue. We had a major increase in 2014 in home dollars, and it's caught quite a bit last year. So we seem to be holding steady at $2.6 million in total. So I just put that out there as the fact that we have a lot of people that put forth applications for funding, and unfortunately we can't fund them in their totality, which is a harder process, I think, than in years past. All right, so starting with the categories, they're all broken out by different lines and then by different funding mechanisms. So the economic development category is CDBG funding, and we're proposing $30,000 to the community loan fund in the capital region. They've been operating their satellite office on Albany Street since 2014. They've granted 10 loans, 6 for existing businesses and then 4 for new businesses within the community. They hold a number of workshops, business planning courses, and a lot of technical assistance. So we're putting forth $30,000. Last year we funded it for 28. In the emergency solutions program, we're mostly holding...
Oh, Jackie.
Can I just stop real quick? Yeah. Could you said 10 loans, and could you give me the breakdown of what the loans were for again?
Yes. 6 were for existing businesses, mm-hmm. 4 were for new businesses.
Okay.
And I actually have it more detailed out if you'd like me to share that with you.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. All right. The Emergency Solutions Grant Program, this is mostly holding steady from last year's proposed adopted allocations. Bethesda House doing homeless housing and eviction prevention. SCAP is doing the same thing, so I can kind of talk about them at the same time. They do trying to ensure that people who come through their shelter are kind of have wraparound services to help them get on their feet and not continue to go to shelters. And be able to have a little bit of permanency in their life. The Bethesda House Day Program Drop-In Center is kind of a similar thing, except it's for the day program drop-in center. local administrator of our continuum of care. They're also the local administrator of most of the capital region counties. So in doing the administration of the continuum of care, they also administer the homelessness management information system for us. And that's where everybody puts in their data and tracks in the homelessness population within the capital district. Safe Inc. is to fund the house manager and street outreach worker at Safe House, the emergency shelter for the runaway and homeless youth, and they do great work in the community. So you see the allocation there. Yeah. Under the housing assistance recommendations for this year, we have, again, I'm going to group Bethesda and SCAF together. Both of them are doing different forms of services under the same guise of the home program. The funds for Bethesda House are used for subsidies, security deposits, and rental assistance for individuals who are at risk of being homeless or who are at risk of being evicted, whereas SCAF is having tenant-based rental assistance for families. We have one individual from one family, both of which are very important. B&I, we're going to talk about both of them in the same regard. So as a community housing development organization, we have both B&I and Community Land Trust. They both are allocated a certain amount of our home dollars for their operating and administrative costs. So that's where you see those allocations for both of those. And Better Neighborhoods also put forth program delivery monies to employ their construction manager to oversee their projects that we have currently going on. With Community Land Trust, we put forth a little for Housing Counseling Administration, and it's more or less credit repair. You'll see later we have Better Neighborhoods putting forth the housing counseling. It's different. This is just for doing some credit repair and minor work with some of our folks who need a little assistance. Community Land Trust could also put forth a recommendation for homeowner occupied or first time home buyer housing rehab. This is to continue and expand the service that we currently offer. The funds will be used to assist 10 income eligible homeowners with housing rehab, particularly code violations. With home dollars, you have to bring the entire house to code to be able to do any rehab work. So that's why for tenants, it's a lot of money, but it's not easy to bring everything to code. For the Department of Development, we're kind of correcting some administrative monies we put forth in prior years. We used to have much more money put into the administrative code for staff offsets. This is actually correcting it, so we're allowed to do things under what's called program delivery. So you'll see that the allocation in the administration line is reduced. It's now here, and it's broken out between CDBG and home dollars. The Habitat for Humanity proposal is to continue the townhomes construction. We're currently trying to identify a few sites. It sort of depends on what happens with our upcoming foreclosure. But we're putting forth a proposal to build two additional townhomes, two-story townhomes, similar to what's currently going on Cary Street. And last but not least, the Scanty Housing Development Fund Corporation, the second mortgage program. We've had quite a lot of interest and we keep running out of money. And Ahmad in my office staffs that on our behalf. So the funds are used to provide clothing or down payment assistance to a maximum of 10% of the purchase price for an owner-occupied house for a low or moderate income individual citywide. So they come to us kind of for gap financing. Under the neighborhood revitalization category, these are all CDBG dollars. The CNI program is what I just mentioned. It's homebuyer education and housing counseling, which is actually a requirement of anybody receiving any home dollars in the community, any project we have. So all Community Land Trust clients have to go to take one of these courses. So it's a very important thing to our community. Hamilton Hill Arts Center, the project outreach, $25,000 to offset the executive director's salary. And MGTAP technical support services for business counseling and education to increase participation for construction activities predominantly in the Hamilton Hill and Central State. All right, so I've divvied out public service by two slides so we can all see it. So the Boys and Girls Club, it's the Quackenbush Park education and recreational program as well as the Steinmetz Park management. Program that through CDBG, actually these are all through CDBG dollars. Later on we'll get to the Youth Bureau where the offset back, so I can talk about them in total at the same time. The Capital District Center for Independence, which is in the ground floor of this building, putting forth for operational costs for them to provide services to the community here and be kind of in a one-stop shop when they come to City Hall. recommendation for kitchen remodeling for their facilities where they provide meals for children and youth in the community. And they're actually offsetting quite a lot of private donations and Home Depot putting forth some money for equipment. So it's a kind of chip in for the overhaul of the kitchen. Schenectady Basketball Club, this was what you all put into the final hours last year at $4,500. They've been doing great. They came in mass at the public hearing asking for more money. They've been great to work with, and as they kind of get their feet wet in their startup funds, we are requesting a double allocation from last year to $9,000. And finally, staff is doing this very inventive pilot program with the county social services department right now, where they are engaged in a contract to provide services to those that are put in emergency motel stays. So this pilot program that they've put forth for funding through us this year is to provide like intensive wraparound services for a few families to ensure that they get them out of the motel stay kind of as soon as possible, and then also to prevent the reoccurrence of that happening because of how disruptive that is to the family unit. So they put forth the proposal. We put a little bit of money towards it. Very innovative, and they want an RFP, I guess, from the county to provide the service. So moving on. So to talk about kind of the entirety of the school program. So Snake Youth Bureau reinforced recommendation for Front Street, Hillhurst, and Stennis Park programs. This year we were able to engage with the YWCA and have them kind of take a step back of operations of the Front Street pools, become not cost effective for them to do so, and also kind of expand the program in a way that suits the community in a much better way, and also provides for their ability to actually receive funding. Because of various circumstances, they were no longer eligible to receive this money from this allocation. So we have like a holistic look now at the Parks and Pools program between the Boys and Girls Club and the Youth Bureau. SICM is a summer lunch program at $5,000. The Skanky Youth Boxing and Fitness, same logic as applies to the basketball club. They've done a great job, great program they've got going on, so we've increased their allocation to $9,000. And TVU Productions, which is Prince Rob's arts and training program, come to us to look for some funding, also to receive some funding from the Schenectady Foundation. We put forth a recommendation for $10,000. It's kind of in partnership of buying some equipment and also to employ one or two youth through the program that have gone through his actual youth program, but then to employ them as a full-time worker for the program. And the YMCA is for the Jerry Burrell Fund program. Public Works, we've got code enforcement for program delivery, and the revised amount of funding is to help for corrections relative to the regulations that HUD put out, and what we're actually eligible to get back for certain things that are eligible from the federal government. Department of Development is a community development program delivery. This is a line that's there every year. It's to offset one of our planning staff to do implementation of our comprehensive plan measures. We also have Department of Development and proposal for continuation of demolition of properties. This is probably going to be more along the lines of six, I think a little high estimated, but that's probably one of five. five properties for that amount of money. The engineering department would be the street rehab and reconstruction program for approximately 1 mile of CDBG eligible streets and also include the ADA compliance measures. The Office of General Services, the SNAP program at $350,000. We've been able to redesign the way we do the program to maximize the way in which we can receive reimbursement.
Thank you.
information. The 30-day comment period begins on April 6th, which is Wednesday. Public notice goes in the Gazette that day as well. Open until May 5th. Written comments are submitted to the Department of Development on the next slide, which is my address. Public hearing is scheduled to be held on April 25th upstairs in the Council Chambers at 7 p.m., which is a regularly scheduled City Council meeting. And yes, and then if anyone has any questions or for more information, just my contact information.
Go ahead, Ms. Brown. Questions? Let the fun begin.
First of all, can you supply us with a brief synopsis of each program along with what the funding level was last year? At your leisure.
Somewhere in your packet of information, you've got that. This document has all of the summaries of each of the programs in more detail. But I can definitely, I have the request form as well, so this is what the requests were, but I can also give you what was funded last year.
Yeah,
I can definitely do that.
Any other comments, discussions?
Well, this new program, the Home Connections Pilot, that SCAP is doing, so people that are in, that get to have to be in hotels for emergencies. Mm-hmm. So the goal here is that they don't stay 2 years?
There's kind of what the county's contracted with SCAP to do is kind of one level, and then what they're proposing to do with us is another level. So what the county has contracted with SCAP to do is to kind of provide intensive case management and wraparound services to one, get them kind of stabilized and move out of that kind of emergency shelter, it's not really a shelter, into some form of temporary housing, transitional housing, or permanent housing, most likely not permanent housing, for kind of that gap period to get them out of the hotel stays because that's not good and to put them into something else that is more, either leading to permanency or more safe and secure for the family. Mm-hmm. What they're asking from us is to provide additional funding to kind of put like a one-on-one caseworker to a few of their high-risk, high-need families, to the ones that are repeat offenders that go through that system over mm-hmm. and over and over again, that, disruptive to the children and everything like that, is to kind of, put the dollars towards 2 to 3 caseworkers, 2 families, and see if this will work going forward.
Any other comments? If I can just make one point with the Front Street Pool, as Jackie had mentioned and John was talking as well, we partnered with Roy Taylor at the YWCA. Unfortunately, the Y has been losing money for the last 3-4 years operating the pool, the Front Street Pool. So I met with Roy Taylor and said, is there any way we can partner with her and run the program again through the Youth Bureau and partnering again with the Boys and Girls Scout for the lifeguards. And she was ecstatic about the whole thing. We're still going to offer the swimming lessons, still going to offer the water aerobics that she offered to a lot of folks. There's also some free swim time for the women and children who are in shelters. So we'll also have that. But the best thing is there's no longer going to be a fee to participate or to swim at the Front Street Pool. I think that was one of the things that I kind of always didn't like. It was $2, I believe, for an adult and maybe $1.50 for a child. And so it is a city pool, and since we're taking it over, those fees will be waived, and it'll be free swim for everybody. Again, they'll still require the same identification process that we did at all the pools regarding the photo ID and the code of conduct that we have at every pool currently. So we'll just continue to do that. But I think it's a great partnership, and I'm sure she called you and very excited about the whole process.
It brings the program into compliance with our regulations.
Yes.
Which was a big flag on my end, so
right.
I'm very happy.
All right. And John, thank you for helping us through that whole piece as well.
Yes.
Any other comments on anything? So again, we're just simply calling for the public hearing here, mm-hmm. correct? So we'll have 2 public hearings in one.
Yeah, 2
public hearings. That'll be good. I think it's a good idea.
So we need a motion.
We need a motion. Ms. Porfield, second by Mr. Baltimore. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much, and Jackie, thank you, and your lovely assistant over there, working the slides. Van White. All righty, discussion here, naming the streets.
Yes, funny enough, although it's coming up in close proximity, it has nothing to do with naming the streets at Mohawk Harbor. So I have been approached by someone who is interested in naming a street after a loved one, and it just dawned on me that we don't really have any procedure. I know that Mr. Riggi brought to the table the renaming of a portion of
Norwood.
Mike Miataway, and we had a public hearing and things of that nature, but it is quite a subjective process right now, and I'm not sure that the council should be in the position of saying, yes, we think your loved one is worthy of a street name, or no, we don't think your loved one is worthy of a street name. I know it makes me uncomfortable because, you know, who am I to decide, or who are we to decide? So our clerk did pull a couple of examples of different municipalities and what they require to rename a street. I know it's a lot of information to take in tonight, but I would like to put it on the agenda for 2 weeks and ask that you study the guidelines and come back to the table with your recommendations, or whether you even want to formalize a process or not. I think it would be valuable for us to do at this stage of the game. I know that in the last month we had 2 requests. So something for consideration. I'm not sure, you know, where everybody else, how everybody else feels about it, whether we want to put it on the agenda for 2 weeks or not.
Mr. One problem that comes up, and that's why I made sure that part of Norwood didn't have any houses on it, because the biggest pushback comes, people have to change everything that they have, they're identified with, their driver's license, everything, because their street name is going to change, and that becomes a real issue for sure.
Absolutely.
Ms. Corbett?
I agree, because that is it, and because actually someone sent me an email as well saying, you know, this person has done so much in the community, and we don't know how long they're going to be here, so can we name this street after them? So there are people that want to do that and are going to want to do that, I'm sure, in the future. In addition to that, when there was a church that wanted to rename a street, but since it takes so much and people have to change their addresses and all that, and I'm pretty sure that we would have to talk to the people that live on that street, what they did was just create a ceremonial name. So the street maintained its name with the United States Post Office, and your mail always came there, but then there was a ceremonial street sign that hangs under it, so that they have that name. I know they've done that in Albany on different streets as well, so that may be something to consider. Because if it's a long street and only you want only this block named Ed Kosher Boulevard, and then and it skips over and the rest of the street becomes something else, and it gets a little cumbersome.
Like Parkview Sanitarium.
So I think those are all things that we should consider, because we could live on the same street, and my street could be named one park thing, and yours could be named another. So it affects a lot of people. It's a nice honor, but it affects a lot of people.
Very good. All right, so we'll do some homework and do some reading, right?
Mm. Yeah.
Very good. Chuck, thank you for looking into that. We appreciate that. All right, so we have to move to recess our committee, is that correct?
Yes.
For the next 7 through 11?
Yes.
All right. Sitting in motion to recess. Mm-hmm. Ms. Borfield, Ms. Multivaron, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye, and we are in recess. Thank you.
I call to order public service and utilities. We have 2 items on the agenda. First is a discussion about brush pickup regulations. Ms. Alfont.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Well, it's a discussion. I know we had a couple residents call. We have no formal written agenda or schedule for our brush pickup. Typically, and historically, the city is around April 1st. We put our brush pickup trucks out on the road. This year, we had some very good weather, Friday, April 1st, and we had a few people call in wanting to know when we're picking up brush. And a lot of the answers were
start the week, April, and it wasn't acceptable work. So without a formal policy, we don't have a schedule that says April 1 to December 1 is brush pickup, and then we would schedule the staff. We have seasonals that we hire to bring on, and we prepare some of the packers for brush pickup. There's a couple confusing pickups where some brush got put in some packers because it was on the curb, but we didn't have brush pickups. So in order to alleviate all of that, I think we should formalize a schedule with the city's committee. When we're going to start our brush pickup, and we set a date, and we set a date, the end of the brush pickup. I mean, it's very typical in the inner communities. They have a schedule, when yard waste pickup starts. They start putting out their biodegradable bags with the leaves and stuff. And unfortunately, we don't have an established schedule or plan. So we did get a number of residents calling in. Not calling today for brush, but
snow plow.
Because the blacktop plant's open. I think it's. We agreed about policy to set something up where we can discuss a schedule, whether it's March 15th, it really doesn't matter. But this way we have a policy and a schedule set out there. We can put it out just like we do with our trash collection. We're on the website that brush pickup starts X and it ends on X.
So this is a me. I'm the one that wanted to talk about this because I do feel like right now it's a gray area, which caused Mr. LaFon to have to go out of his way and kind of react to a situation that and he did so very adeptly, and the homeowner was very happy. But it just to me, if we have an unspoken rule. An unspoken rule is a gray area that ends up just being confusing to people. So I wasn't looking for the council to set any regulation. I would look for Mr. LaFon's recommendation. It may not even be a set date. It may be that the city will give you 2 weeks notice in the spring before brush pickup. I mean, right, this April 1st is really different from last April 1st. So we may not always do pickup on March 15th or whatever the case may be.
There could be snow on the ground still.
Yes. But this one particular neighborhood, what happened was, everybody dragged their leaf bags out. I didn't know that we had a restriction on it. I would have been one of those people. And then what happens is either the leaf bags stay there or garbage then has to pick them up, or we have to send around a special truck that don't have staff for yet. So I just thought it would be a worthy discussion to put some sort of parameters and some sort of guidance. So maybe when we do the next recycle brochure, we say, please be aware that the city gives 2 weeks notice at the start of brush cleanup or at the end of brush cleanup. Go to our website, or we put an ad in the paper. I don't know what it looks like, and I'd be happy to follow any your recommendation as
a department head. Right now, it's sort of open. And the way it is written in as being open, if somebody technically was to put brush out in February, because it's a good time for pruning before buds come up, we don't have something said that, we don't have people to go out there and really start picking up brush or clippings in February. Mm-hmm. And we could have a nice February like we have now, not a lot of snow, people out there doing some pruning and losing it, but we don't have the staff on it, we don't have the equipment ready to do the pickup. Typically, don't do that until around April 1st.
And I think that's even fine as long as our homeowners know. They go outside and they do the pruning, leave it in your garage, leave it on your back porch, leave it, wherever. You can't put it out yet to the curb. And then that,
do like a lot of people, just blow it on somebody else's.
I have a neighbor.
Yeah, there you go.
I actually have a neighbor that does a lot of work in the street.
Send some suggestions over.
That'd be great. Any other
things? Just a quick question, but we can change it. Let's say there's a storm and there's a lot of tree limbs down, or so we'll have a special pickup or something like that.
In previous years, we had ice storms, yeah. Limbs. Yeah. That's more of an emergency. We've gone out, the packers have gone out, the park department gone out, everybody's gone out to clear the street with the streets. That's not typical, but it's.
Right.
It's an emergency. We want to get the streets clear. But just everyday pruning, or a week of nice weather, and, end of March, between end of March, and we're just not, we're not equipped to pick everything up at that time. We can be, if we know we have a schedule, we will accommodate the taxpayer and the residents of Stanley.
Any other questions? Thank you. Look forward to your information. Second item on the agenda is amend section 151 and 228 regarding street repair. Mr. Valentino.
Mr. Bailey, Ryan Bailey from my office, Assistant Corporation Counsel, has been working hard on this legislation. He's going to give a copy to the council and then take it through. This is an issue that we originally discussed a little last fall, then went on kind of the back burner for a little while, but now Ryan has been working with engineering to finalize it.
Okay. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ryan Daly. I'm an assistant borough counsel for the city of Schenectady. I've been working here for about a year and a half now. A little while ago, Carl approached me about working on this project. He and Chris Wallen had some discussions about some reoccurring issues that engineering was experiencing with some of their street repairs. The purpose of me being here tonight is to request legislation to call for a public hearing to enact certain amendments to section 151 and 228, or chapters 151 and 228 of the city code. What I've handed out is a working draft of the proposed legislation that I've been working on with Chris Wallen. So let me discuss a little bit briefly what 151 and 228 of the city code address. 151 addresses excavation work performed in the city. Generally speaking, it discusses permits, requirements, insurance, and certain work standards. And speaking with Chris Wallen, there have been some reoccurring issues that he has had to address. And he'd like to see if the city's attorney can work to identify these issues and legislate them. So the biggest concern that engineering has expressed to me is the issue of excavation work failing after a few years. So the way the code is currently drafted, it's silent as far as how much time a contractor needs to guarantee their work that they perform on city streets. The legislation that I'd like to propose includes a five-year period for when contractors need to guarantee their work. And in the event that their restoration work fails within five years, they'll be required to refill, re-excavate, and repave any permanent restoration work that fails. The next, also under 151, generally speaking, a proposal that I'd like to suggest to the City Council is to make it a requirement that 30 days after project completion, all excavation work be repaved and permanently restored. There's a provision in there to address winter conditions. Obviously in the winter it's not always possible to permanently restore the pavement. So I have a provision in there discussing what to do in winter conditions. Now as for 228 generally speaking just addresses city streets and sidewalks. There's a lot of different provisions discussing the duties that the city homeowners have, maintenance requirements, and the types of cuts that might be made in city streets and sidewalks. Legislation that I'd like to present involves planning for capital improvement projects. One of the issues that engineering has come across is they'll have a capital improvement project planned out a couple years down the road, and after they've performed the capital improvement project, someone comes in and they cut up the street. And it's been frustrating for him. So I've been working with Chris to try and draft some legislation that will deal with this situation and also hold those that improperly repair city pavement following instructions, accountable for the work that does not meet city standards. Again, what I've handed out today is a working draft. It's still evolving. I'm still working on it. But I would like to request that the city hold a public hearing on this matter. Does anyone have any questions?
Ms. Parkfield?
With regard to the five-year period, let's say, for instance, someone does something and it fails within those 5 years, and then they have to repair that. Does the clock then start again for another five-year period after that repair that they've done?
Well, my interpretation, at least the way that I drafted it, that it would not start again. So the 5 years starts at the time the city initially accepts the restoration work. The scenario that Chris and I were running over, I mean, this could go on forever and ever if restoration work fails and we start the five-year clock again. But that's certainly an issue that I've identified, and I'm going to analyze it a little bit more.
Okay. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
I just want to say bravo. I'm just thanking you for starting this, thank you for working on this. I'm consistently frustrated with the condition that our streets are left in. Broadway over here, Mexican Radio, is like crazy looking. I mean, there's a huge recess and then a huge hump to the curb. Edison Avenue was in terrible disrepair after utilities came in there and worked, and they just walk away, and I just think we absolutely need to hold them accountable. And what I anticipate happening is they do a good and thorough job the first time so that they don't have to come back and repair. So I'm really excited to see this come to fruition, and I'm looking forward to looking it over, and I agree with once the clock starts. I mean, how many times are they going to want to come back in 5 years to fix it without just fixing it right the first time? So I'm, for one, very pleased.
This might not make any sense, but the question is, would it be sensible to make sure that they're pulling a permit for this? The inspector, they wait until the inspector's there to make sure the holes are filled.
So, as I understand it, typically engineering will they'll issue a permit for the work. The contractor will go out, they'll do the work, and engineering will then obviously go and inspect the work. But in a lot of instances where there might be latent defects, things that you don't necessarily see right away. And so that's kind of what we're trying to address, these things that they fail over a period of time. They're not noticeable right away.
Because I know on Union Street there were a number of real, and I'm going to assume, which is dangerous, that it wasn't done correctly in the first place. And people thinking they could just get away with something and make it look nice, and then 6 months later, there's a big dip.
Yep.
And that's why I was asking maybe have the inspector there in the first place.
Yeah, it's, I don't know that much about the technical aspects, but I'm sure there's a way you can make it look so that it's repaired. But in reality, whatever the materials that they're using, they just don't hold up over time. And so that's what I think Chris is looking for me to try and address.
Mr. Reed? I agree with Ms. Perrazzo. Thank you for putting this together, because it's been a long time coming. And National Grid has been the biggest offender of the cutouts in the city. They're just awful. But I think with the five-year window, that's good, because it would make the contractor certainly try to do as best they can, because if they're going to have to put a five-year warranty on this, I think they're going to do the best job they can. Everything, I think, is compacting, right? I mean, to get a good fill, you got to make sure it's compacted good. I think that's where most of the repairs fail, it seems like. So this is certainly a good process, something a long time coming. Thank you for your hard work with it.
Any other questions?
So have we talked with any of our contractors or National Grid or to see what their feedback is? Didn't we get some Didn't somebody come to the rail on this a while back and was complaining about what we're doing here, if I recall?
Yeah, I can address that one. National Grid, we met with them before the legislation was originally proposed. Then after the public hearing, they sent an attorney to make some comments. We met with them afterwards, and this new draft, we've taken those comments into consideration. We're going to pass a comment or a version of this over to the attorney who was at the public hearing. And they haven't been adversarial with this process. Their comments were more about just making sure everything is well-defined so it's clear enough that they can know they're doing it right.
And just to follow up, and I think Mr. Palmeni's comment is right on the button, too. I think, I don't want to say 9 out of 10, but quite a few of these holes is because we don't have anybody there inspecting the job. I know many folks have had water line replacements, all this National Grid stuff with the subcontractors. I know we're very busy, but I really have never seen our city folks at these job sites. And I think they're getting away with it because they know they can get away with it. And I think we have to hold up our end of the bargain as well. If we're holding up to this standard, you know, that they have to backfill it properly, I think we have to make sure that our folks are there observing the work and making sure it's done properly. Just like I said, you know, Union Street and in front of Mexican Radio, that's all new stuff, and there's no reason for that to be happening. So again, I'm very, very appreciative of this work. Are we looking to call for a public hearing already, or are we looking to digest this for a couple of weeks, or and then come back, or are we comfortable? Actually, just
you think get to public hearing.
Just the public hearing. Just public hearing, right?
That's a process that's going to take a month.
Yeah. All right. So, all right. Very good.
So can we put on for the agenda? Is it for Monday?
No,
we got to put on for the call. Then you got to wait 2 weeks.
Thank you. Thank you.
Gotcha.
I'll move
down.
Okay.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Public hearing being called for April 25th?
Yes.
Yes.
Any other business come before public service and utilities?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
You're
done.
Okay, I will call to order government operations. We accepted award contract for the exciting world of automotive tire changing and balancing.
All of that. Well, this is a request from the government for some equipment for the mechanical manufacturing service. It's tire changers, both medium, light duty, and then they have these tire changing and balances. This will help us get our vehicles back out into operation a little bit quicker. Currently, we take our vehicles up to county for a tire change. We can call somebody in, get the tire off, and bring it to the county. It's to make us more efficient to get our vehicles out, whether it's a police cruiser, a tow car, or even a dump truck. It'll help us immensely in the future.
Oh, raising my hand. So just one bid?
She's got one bid, correct.
But for a piece of equipment?
Yes, it's a couple pieces. The balancer and the tire changer. Right. Okay. These are safe equipment, highly rated. This was put together prior to Mr. Holy leaving.
Mr. Who?
Colin.
Questions, comments, Mr.
Kosher? So are we looking to purchase tires too, Paul, do you think? And maybe
we will purchase tires, not many tires. We'll have a security area, but most of the tires are really available for our vehicles through state contract and a couple of local tire warehouses.
Vendors here.
Yep.
It would make sense, right? If we're going to be doing it, let's keep them on hand. So we'll
keep a couple, you know, basic tires for police cars and then our pickup trucks and seven tires too for some of the dump trucks. Most of our dump trucks and our packers.
Just a question. This service was done previously by the county.
Pardon me?
This service was performed by the county.
Yes. Some of the repairs are being changed by the county.
So we're looking to move this in-house.
Yes.
Questions, Mr. Reed?
No, I think this is a good move. That's a top-of-the-line machine, and I think just with the downtime of taking a vehicle to the county, you have to have two men,
two men
to pick it up. So I think this is a good move to do something like this in-house for sure. And tire delivery for most of the distributors, even if we don't stock a lot, They get them within a couple hours usually.
Pretty readily available.
Yeah, yeah.
And labor?
The labor is our mechanical division.
Well, we get, excuse me, will we have somebody trained, I assume with this machine, I assume they're going to be training about?
Well, we'll ensure that they're training about when machines are delivered.
Yeah.
We've been trying to do most of our stuff, even on some of our trucks, our van trucks, our camera trucks. When I write the specs for those, I'm requiring all 40 hours of onsite training. That means our trucks, when they're out in the field, that there's a manufacturer or rep there with us for 40 hours. Not just stop and drop it off, give us the manual, leave it a half hour.
No, I assume the vendor's going to be supplying this, I would hope, yeah.
Actually, if I could interject, the bid was for the installation and training, the organization purchase. So that's all security.
Most everything we're ordering now, we're making sure that we get the proper training.
Any other questions, comments?
Good move, very good move.
Second. Seconded by Mr. Ferrari, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, very good. Self-tire changer and a balancer.
Thank you.
Thank you. There you go. You have to trick me that way. Okay, let's do that again.
Trouble.
Mr. Palmeni, that was you. Would someone like to make a motion?
I'll move it.
Okay, seconded by Mr. Palmeni. Mr. Booker, did you want to?
No, no, not at this time.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Okay.
That's really a call for public hearing.
Very good. Next, discussion of waiver of building permit fees. And this time it is you, Mr. Booker.
Yes. A few weeks ago, I brought this to the council, looking at permit fee waiver for exterior residential work. And I put it on hold because Mr. Palmini and Mr. Kosher wanted to add the property tax exemption for the capital improvement on these properties. And we're looking at spread it out in eight increments of 8 years.
So, that's,
so can you just give us a...
So this is what the... Everybody should have a copy of this document. To make it easy, it's the one that's got the 8 years at the bottom. And basically, this is what we're allowed to do by the state. We can make some minor changes to this. So for example, let's say we wanted to give the 100% exemption for years one and two instead of just year one. We could do that. I did. I'm getting a second confirmation of that. I did check into that with some people at the state, and waiting for a second confirmation just to make sure. But this is basically what's laid out by the state as to what we can do.
Okay, so let's rewind and start from the beginning. So what we're looking at is we're looking to waive the fees to get building permits, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Permits, cost of work, and application fee.
Right. And then, as a second, Mr. Palmeni is proposing that after the work is completed and possibly the assessment increases, that people get exemption on that increase.
On the value added.
Right. On the increase over the course of an 8-year period.
Correct.
I think it's important for the neighborhood revitalization programs that we're trying to push out there and raise property values in our neighborhoods. It'll certainly make things nicer looking and encourage people on both sides of the proposal to do repairs. And I think that's what we're looking and we want as homeowners and people that live in the city, as well as just trying to get things done.
Okay. And after year 8, it would go to a full, it would be zero exemption?
Correct.
They would go in
the 100%.
Okay. So I'm going to put Ms. DeGenova on the spot here for a minute. You had sent us an email some time ago. I have it if you don't, and I would like you to walk the council through the email because it's been a little while since we've looked at that information.
What I did in the beginning of March was just to take a look at activity for the period that was being discussed, which was a June 1 through August 31 period. And during 2015, in total, there were approximately 385 residential permits that were issued. Only 118 of those permits were for exterior work, defined as discussed at that time. And this is including siding, decks, windows, doors, sheds, but it does not include porches. So those 118 permits generated revenue of approximately $10,720 for the city and represented about $496,000 of improvement value, which may not necessarily relate to a change in someone's assessment. So assuming the city went forward with a waived permit, and the $50 application fee that everyone pays when they start this process, if the application fee was part of the waiver, then the city would have lost about $10,400 of revenue. And if the application fee was not waived, it would have lost about $4,500 of revenue. Now, from a cost perspective, I think that gives you things at a very, very high level. It was determined that our existing system that tracks the permit issuing process and the financial component of it could be used to track these waivers, but it would take us a little bit of programming time, but that is not any concern or an issue other than the fact that we need just a little bit of time. The bigger issue may be considering that there's a staffing component that is relevant, because assuming that this would, doing something like this is really probably going to incentivize people to jump on to this area of the calendar, which is already an area that is pretty heavy with this type of activity. So that's what I was able to look at it from a very broad level, and that was doing the waiver as discussed initially.
Just on that, that's a good point you made, because that department is really stretched as far as they can go with all the development that's going on around. So I don't know if that's going to mean putting on more staff or not putting on more staff, but they are really stretched out. That's for sure.
I have to make a clarification. Okay. This is what we have on the books already. Kind of messed up my words.
Yeah.
So, and then, but the state does allow us to make some minor changes.
Okay. So this is actually already in place, we're just not utilizing it.
Correct.
Nobody
utilizes
it.
Okay.
Let me just go back.
Yes, Mr. McFerrin.
I mean, what we're looking here is just a pilot project, just for, this year. We're not saying that it's going to happen every year. We're looking at June to August of this year, and maybe revisit it next year. So it's not something we're going to tax the staff and more. It's just a pilot project, look at what's happening, look at our neighborhood revitalization. If a lot of people are buying into this program, we'll revisit it and look at it more on a broader scale, and maybe look at adding additional staffing. But I don't think the impact would be big in terms of staffing. I mean, how much more permits are we going to get? 118 plus 50% more? Nobody knows.
Do we know what our peak year was by any chance, Deb? I mean, you didn't go back two or 3 years or anything, right? Just to see where we were the last two or three?
Maybe? No, I did not. I just was trying to get a sense of what the cost might be.
If that was a peak or not, or where we are. Go ahead.
Basically, I think Mr. Schilling or staff in codes had done an analysis, and then I separately did one, and we were, I don't think there is much of a change, but I haven't looked so I really can't say for sure. But it seems pretty static. I mean, the only difference between R2 analysis is that I really got into the structure of the fee, which is actually a tiered structure. It's not just a percentage, and it depends upon the value. And I looked at each permit that was issued. What isn't taken into account, and I believe everyone at the table is referring to, is if indeed this is successful, and or depends on how you define success. But if you find yourself in a situation where you realize you have to go and you have to monitor all of these permits after 3 months and make sure that they're done. If they're not done, then you leave them on. There is that engagement of the city staff, and I did not put any type of value on there because that's a sort of tough thing.
Well, I mean, that would happen in any permit. You have to get up there. There's a certain timeline. You have to get up there. There have to be interaction with the officers and the owners in terms of the permit.
Is it a one-year permit? Is that what you get for a permit? Is it a one-year to get your project complete?
Yeah, but there are interaction between the officers and the owners in terms of, you know, finalizing it, closing it to make sure everything is in compliance. Mm-hmm. So it's the same kind of work in terms of closing it, going through it, a more shorter scale in terms of getting it. But if they didn't complete it within the 3 months, you revert back to the original.
So you want them to complete the project
within
3 months,
the project.
Not
that's
just grab the permit.
Yeah.
So you're not giving them a year.
No. It's 3 months to complete. This is a pilot. This is like getting out there, the permit fee waiver for 3 months.
So if I get my permit on August 15th, I've got 3 months from August 15th.
No.
August 15th, you have 15 days
right.
to be in this program.
Well, that doesn't make any sense to me, guys. Come on.
I'm not even sure that we can, our building permits are for a year, our building permits are for a year, right? Or can we bypass that?
You could change the legislation, which says how long the building permits are good for. I would just hope there's a mechanism to instruct the city. Somebody gets it, they are exempt from the permit, and then how do we get the money afterwards if they go beyond the date to complete the work?
We also have to assume, I think it's a good assumption, that those people that we're talking about probably wouldn't have gotten a permit in the first place, so the staff would have likely, hopefully, gotten engaged with them at some point. So.
So one of my thoughts was, instead of opening it up as a 3 month pilot, do we open it up as a 1 month pilot? But then the counter thought to that is, okay, so now do we have 300 people that would have come in over 3 months coming in over 1 month? You know, so it might create more of a bottleneck than not. But I personally feel a little awkward around the three, you have to complete your project in 3 months. I mean, just a million things can happen, right? We can have inclement weather every weekend, or, you know,
wrong stuff ordered and delivered.
Yeah, I mean, that's I think if we're going to open up a period of time, that we just have to stick with our current regulations of giving that person the year to complete. I mean, just a million, somebody can fall ill. I mean, there's just a million things that could happen. You know, I know I'm gonna, do a project this summer, and I would be a wreck if I had to make sure it was,
That's exactly what I was thinking. I thought just do the full. I mean, apply. These would be the 3 months that we'd have to apply: the June, July, and August.
Mm-hmm.
But still give that homeowner the year to complete the project, as long as the permit is still good, and then to be able to get into the capital tax exemption here. Again, it's capped at $80,000 as well.
Yes.
So I think that's very important to us. But again, there's so many, and John, you and all of us. I mean, we've all ordered siding, we've ordered windows and stuff that just come in wrong. And if I get a permit on August 15th, you're telling me I have 15 days to complete it. It's not going to happen. But I mean, when we're out there, and again, Vince, we all campaigned this year, and that's how we talk about this. One of the biggest things is people do not want to invest in their property because the first thing you do is raise their taxes. It's exactly what they said. Why am I going to put new windows or new siding on there when the city's going to come and raise my taxes? And I think this is a wonderful program here. We can work with that and work with the exemption. But one final question, how do we get this out to the public? I'm even foreseeing the few, how do we get this word out to people as well that we're doing this? And I don't know if we've thought about that at all either.
Certainly the neighborhood meetings.
So that's exactly what I was going to add. I mean, get this out, get this out to the neighborhood associations, we'll, you know, meet with individual, meet with groups, and let them know that this is available, tap into it, and utilize it.
We also have a brand new city website that's actually usable, and we have social media, you know, also.
Get things at Home Depot and Lowe's.
That's what I was saying, exactly. Can you partner with them and Bellevue Builders and all those guys?
We could put this right up in the code office.
Yes.
I was going to read that whole thing. It's too much to read. Seriously, you got to condense it for me.
You can make it a half a page document.
Exactly.
So that actually bears an interesting question. Right. So if I'm coming in off the street, I don't know anything about this program, and I'm putting a deck in my house.
June 5th, you came for
the permit. Is it automatically that the fee is waived for me, or do I have to ask?
No, once you're within that bracket and you're doing the exterior work, you fall within that category, yes.
Kind of like a parking lot.
I'll be putting my permit in May. Oh,
well, you better wait.
Anybody think I'm taking advantage of this program?
Whoa, what?
Just wait 1 month.
I'll wait for my pool.
I think you were saying you were thinking about posting this in codes. Mm-hmm. It's not appropriate for me because I'm not the assessor for the city, but I don't know that you can say that if you go and you do this work and you're going to. Somehow, I think we have to communicate whether or not there is a change in the assessed value is a one-by-one process. It's not
automatic.
It's not if you participate in this program,
right,
then you're automatically eligible for this based on what the city council is saying, but that might infer that something is actually going to occur, and there may not be a change in valuation. That's the city's assessor.
Right. That's what we discussed a few weeks ago is that many of the projects that people actually undertake really don't change the assessment. But this would be for those that would. And certainly, I think it's fairly clear in here that it's only for those value-added projects that would affect your assessment.
And if we were to go through a reassessment at some point in the future, it's got to be discussed, though. This amount would stay the same. So if you put a $40,000 sunroom on the back of your house, and your house was reassessed for something lower than it is now, the $40,000 would stay the same out of that.
You're talking about this program now, or just overall?
I'm talking about if somebody took part in this program and deferred their, or took part of the exemption, and then we did a reassessment, what would that look like?
Well, if you look at if you're looking at the sunroof, we are only talking about siding, the roof, we're talking,
it's a dollar amount. Yes. Yes, Carl.
I can look into it specifically with this exemption. In general, the way it would work is, like you said, the work you do on the property is worth a certain amount that's defined at the time you apply for this exception and when you get the building permit. And then a reassessment will just be looking at your market value as a whole, and that wouldn't change what this is.
Okay. I just think it's an important question to really get an answer on. Not that that's a discussion that we're having right now, but it is, because it's over an 8-year period, it's something that we need to consider also, I think.
Really, this is sort of a question for Mr. Mubarin, because I know that you wanted a 3-month window in terms of this program. There a specific reason? I mean, was it because you're trying to create an effect in a short period of time so we could see the revitalization, or how did you come up with that?
The idea was to create a pilot project to see how many people will tap into this incentive, to encourage people to buy into this and to revitalize the neighborhood. So it's more like a 3-month was just thrown there. I mean, you can revert back to the original 1 year, which is good. Some people will be happy, more than happy, for a year to do this. But I was just looking at the 3 months to encourage people to get it, pull the permit, get it done within 3 months. And this is the program is for that. And then look at it on a long-term basis to see, was it, you know, successful? Did we get people to buy into it? Mm-hmm. Can we, you know, look at it next year, kind of thing.
Well, in terms of that, I mean, usually a pilot is a shorter period of time. So extending it out a year, It seems to me that maybe we need to just even narrow it down to 6 months. But a pilot just really needs to kind of like be a real serious, kind of, in this case, I would say, a focused amount of time so that we can really see what the results would be. And if we're only talking about repairs, we're not talking about really major innovations here. We're talking about repairs. If 3 months is too short, okay. I don't think that 6 months is is too short to do repairs, to do painting, to fix your rails. And generally, it's going to be during a certain time frame that people are going to do repairs anyway. When the weather starts to get inclement, people start to move away from that. So even if we could look at maybe doing it in a 6 month time frame, we can really be able to look and see if this really made a significant impact within communities. If people took advantage of it, it's a little easier to track on a lot of levels. So I think we might want to consider if there's a way to be able to do that, to do that within a shorter period of time than extending it out into the year. It just makes more sense in terms of trying to do a pilot.
And that was one of the reasons why I kind of look at the 3 months. But 6 months is okay. I mean, I don't have a problem with 6 months.
So we're talking. You're talking about 6 months waiving the fee? Is that what you're talking about?
No.
You're talking about 6 months to do the work?
Get it done. Yeah.
I see what you're saying. Okay. Because, again, more extending, I mean, we're going to be losing revenue.
No,
I mean, that's revenue on the budget. Don't forget that we have set aside there. But I think the bigger picture, and I like the pilot. I think the pilot is very important. Mm-hmm. But I think this is the bigger piece right here, the capitalization, you know, of being able to do that forever. You know, making my home improvements and you know, working through that 8-year period. Mm-hmm. I think that's the biggest piece. I think that's why I thought piggybacking it would be perfect if you did that, at least to jumpstart with yours. Again, that's when folks are getting their income tax returns anyway. That's kind of the other reason we thought about it. Remember we said, you know, income tax, hopefully you get income tax returns. But that's kind of what I So anyway, I think it's.
I mean, look, I'm open with the timing. The timing is not like we have to have it 3 months. We can have 6 months. We can, you know, whatever. But this is something that we should put forward. The neighborhoods are welcoming you.
Oh yeah.
And we encourage people to you know, to get involved.
Invest.
It's all about neighborhood revitalization. Mm-hmm. You know, improving in property sales, reducing. It's like a whole bunch of positive things that will happen if we can get in there.
Agreed. That actually brings up an interesting point. Because right now we're selling a lot of city properties. We're selling a lot of city properties right now.
Yes, we
are. And we are requesting that those properties come up to code within 6 months for rental, a year for residential. If we were to offer this, all of those properties would go right out of this program to the tune of $80,000, and we would not get property tax revenue for 8 years fully. So we need to think about that.
Do you have to be in a property any amount of time prior to?
No. It says something about 5-year residence.
You have to be a
Yeah.
What's that?
You have to be living in
resident.
It.
So you have to be a resident in that house for 5 years?
After.
Fix it up. So I'm comfortable with attaching this directly to the permit thing, but I'm not comfortable talking about adopting this wholly as is available to anyone, considering the amount of properties we're selling right now and our interest in getting those back on the tax rolls to support our tax base and, you know, many of those be, you know, so just a thought.
So we did say we could possibly change this. Could we put in a requirement that you have had to have been a resident in that property for 2 years prior to, or 3 years, or whatever number we want to pick?
Prior to pulling this permit?
No, I don't care about your permit, but
prior
to the value-added piece, as Ms. Perazzo pointed out, could that be a possibility? Could we say you must have been you must be in this residence for 2 years prior to?
I'll look into that. I can't say no for sure, but I strongly think that we can.
Can't?
You cannot do that. It's mostly if you adopt this this tax exemption like we have. Yeah, and it's already on the books, but you can play with some of the numbers. You can play with the percents in a certain way. A little bit is talked about on the second page, tells you what some of your options are.
We can't do anything else.
But we can attach it to a specific initiative only. It's on the books, but we obviously aren't utilizing it right now.
Anybody could walk to the assessor's office today and put in an application to use this.
They just don't know what's there.
And well, I
right.
reality is we're really not losing anything from a tax revenue point of view by doing this, because the improvements aren't being taxed on now anyway. So that's just an improvement. Yeah, once it was finished and assuming it was reassessed, then we would be losing that revenue. But we aren't, theoretically and in application, losing anything by putting this in place.
Well, but we have people that are buying homes for $10,000, and once they pull the permit, then an inspector is going out there when the work is completed and we're reassessing.
I'm not even talking
about the permit. You know what I mean? So with that part of it, if somebody's buying a house for $10,000 and they're bringing it up to a $90,000 property, essentially we're, you know, getting the tax on $10,000 for the first year, and then.
But we're also raising the property values around the house that's being fixed up.
Right, and I get that, but we're also really trying to strengthen our tax base and ease the burden of our taxpayers.
Understood.
So the two can combat one another.
So I've not brought to a good end right there. So why we should look at maybe look at reducing the cost of improvement rather than up to $50,000, we can say, well, then $25,000.
Yeah. Is that something we could do?
Yes.
Because if I may continue, because most of these houses we're selling, it's over
way
over $25,000. So that way we can like put a limit there. So home improvement, more than likely, as Mrs. Flick says, they might not go over $25,000. But most of these houses we're selling, and they are going over $25,000.
Didn't get that far, but that was going to be an argument to lower that, and also we can even play with the percentages.
Yes.
I like the percentages.
so this will bring us back that we can utilize the 8-year value added, and then we can say, okay, there is a limit on the cost of work, $25,000. Which most of the houses go over while we're selling.
I think that would be wise of us.
That's a good
idea. That way we can
I like that. And are we still gonna? Are we gonna give them a year to complete the work, or 6 months?
I would say 6 months. I don't know.
Because the 6 months, then you become a problem with the permit department, though.
You're gonna have two different permits: one for 6 months, one for a year.
Right.
Maybe somebody will opt out and say, "I'd rather pay for the permit, even though because I want to have a year to do it."
Yeah, that's what I think.
Because some of the permits aren't that expensive to do. You know, if you're gonna do a few $1,000 worth of work.
I mean, I'm going to go to the year, but I don't know.
Yeah, don't make any change in that.
I think consistency for our city staff is a good thing. I get your point, but I think we can also measure it in knowing that.
How many permits are pulled?
That they can give us the last 3 or 4 years data, and then we can measure it and see how many additional permits are pulled. So I think it's measured.
I'm fine with that. I mean, it's all that matters is that we get out there and we can bring something to, give something to our neighborhoods.
Okay, so. We are going to waive just the permit or the $50 application fee as well.
We're looking at permit fees, cost of work fee, and application fee waiver.
Okay.
Waiving everything.
Everything, yes.
Okay, and that's June 1st to
August 31st. So we're looking at you're pulling your permit within the 3 months, but you have 1 year.
1 year from the date of your permit.
Permit to complete it, okay.
Then in addition, we want to promote this program. Because it really is, so this is nothing new, but we want to promote.
But the exemption will be limited to $25,000.
$25,000, yes. So they'll strike on all the bottom here, and it says.
Makes it easier for you. Continue to sell those houses.
We're saying 0 to 25,000. You're not paying any permit fee, 0% in permit fees.
And you're eligible to.
And you're eligible for the value added. Perfect.
Mr. Palatigo, what do we need to do to move forward?
It sounds like you need to, the committee's talking about passing two calls for public hearings, one for a local law to. To amend, I guess, the way that we handle our real property tax exemption for 421F to lower the maximum down to $25,000.
Right.
And then a call for a public hearing to amend whatever the section is where we have our codes fees. And the way that we'll write that, we'll say that the fees, the way we've been doing everything lately is changing it so the fees will be set from time to time by resolution. And then that would, when you have the final passage, we'll have the numbers that we currently have for coach fees plus a section that says no fee for this period of time for certain work, as you've described.
So then what we'll need to do is also call, we need to call for a public hearing to change it back in the fall?
No, the way we could write it is we'll change the actual code to say that fees will be set by resolution, and then we'll pass a resolution.
Oh,
you'll
so
pass
we just
a resolution.
Have to do the resolution. But we do need to have it on the agenda for the fall to change it back as of September 1.
No, we could even write in that resolution that for June 1st, 2016 to
oh,
August 31st, 2016,
okay.
It'll have it end then.
All right, so it's self-healing.
Yeah.
And it'll have this year in it, so
that
next year that won't apply again
automatically. Unless I think about
the
next project next year.
Yes.
Unless we go, it's not going to automatically revert to
correct.
Permit fees being waived
no.
June through August. Okay. So I will first ask for a motion to call for a public hearing to amend the codes section of our. Thank you.
Second.
Thank you, all those in favor.
Aye.
And then I will call for a public hearing to amend the local law for the minimum increased market value to the New York State Department of Taxation and Finance application for real property tax exemption.
Did you say it would be a public hearing to pass a local law, amending previous?
Pass a local law.
Yes.
He'll figure it out.
Yeah.
I'll move it. That's what we've been to be
brought. All right, Mr. Palamedi, all those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Great work.
Very good.
Thank you.
Very good.
Exciting. Okay, on to discussion of nuisance property program. Just to give you a little background on this before I hand it over to Mr. Palamedi. So, this is also something we discussed some time ago. And we were trying to work this out in the IT section of the city. But the basic thought process behind it was that we may very well have landlords within the city of Schenectady that aren't fully aware of what might be happening at their property. So if you live in Amsterdam and you have a property in the city and you have a tenant who pays their rent on time and you keep a good property, but that tenant likes to have parties until 2 a.m. every other night or even every night, and neighbors are calling the police and the police are coming to the property on a regular basis, you may not be aware of that if you don't have another tenant downstairs or if the neighbors don't know who you are or whatever that might be. So it just led to our initial discussion of quality of life issues in our neighborhoods that even our most respected landlords may not be aware of. So Mr. Valentico and I, and along with our IT and the commissioner, have been working on this. And we are to a point where we can actually pull a report on how many times the police have been called to an address and what they've been called to the address for. And then attach a point system to that as to the severity of what's going on at the property. And then when the landlord gets to a certain level, the landlord is contacted and an explanation is made as to what has been occurring on the property. And then if that continues, the landlord would be required to come up with an abatement plan to remove the problem and or the tenant, and the city would offer assistance in that process as it could. So maybe some supporting documentation from the city to help in the eviction process or whatever the case may be. So again, a lot to look at. We've been working on it this long. There's no need to push it through this week. But I thought I would give it to you for your consideration, unless anyone has any discussion points this week, and then put it on the site for 2 weeks. Ms. Porfield.
The way that this particular legislation is, it is if, you know, there's continued complaints from the neighbors, et cetera, and then we the city then goes to the landlord and says, hey,
yes.
You need to do something about that.
Yeah.
What about the case where the landlord realizes there is a problem and they are coming to the city and saying, how can this be remedied? Because that situation happens, where the landlord is really aware that there's something going on in their property, that, and if somebody's paying their rent on time and all that, how do we then assist that landlord who's getting their rent on time, but because of what's going on, doesn't want that particular tenant in their property because it's bringing down the property values, it's affecting other tenants around them. So how is it that we're there, if the landlord is doing a more proactive approach as opposed to us coming to them?
That would be a question for Mr.
Yeah, well, we brought that right into the legislation, to the last section 183-17A. Mm-hmm. You know, if a property owner is having problems with a tenant, they believe the city can help, they can request a meeting with the Appropriation Council's office. In a situation like you described, where somebody's paying their rent, mm-hmm. but they're still a problem tenant, and we could look at the lease, or I could refer the landlord to people who have model leases for landlords that contain clauses that would help them in situations like that. So even if someone's paying, if they're being a problem, they could still get them out of the property.
I mean, because this isn't like theoretical, this is a fact. And so can, if that happens, can someone say they just want them evicted and go through the same process? And is that something that should be a part of this? If someone's paying the rent, but they're causing a problem in the building, and the landlord says, I don't want you here because of the problems that you're causing.
Yeah, we can't do anything at the city level that's going to change the eviction process. It's created and controlled by state law. What we can do is, you know, like we have in here, we sometimes have officers who will testify in an eviction hearing as to what they saw when they went to a property, the condition of it. You know, sometimes we have landlords who will say, I think this tenant is destroying my property, but I don't have a clause in my lease that allows me to get access to it. And the city, when it meets the threshold, can go in there and inspect that property as well. So there are tools that we have to help, but we can't change the whole system.
Can this be sent to all houses, all residents? We have folks that I know continuously a house gets called for noise, continues to get called for animal control, continues to get called for code violations, and their owner occupied.
We can't put people out of them.
Well, can we count points? Didn't we do that with the store on yes. Craig Street, where they had so many problems that they eventually knocked down? It was under Al Drzezinski's administration. Actually, I think the thing burned down.
I think you're talking about Emmett Street.
Was it Emmett Street?
The one that burned down, we had the
right.
storm. But yeah, but I don't think the city did that.
Can't we do points with residents as well? I mean, think about that. I mean,
the homeowner, you
mean? No, can we take them to court? Can we take them to court? Maybe. Can we take them to court? Because the officer is going to come in and say, look, there's nothing we need, or code enforcement is going to be there for the umpteenth time, citing, and I'm talking about Council Road, which is always a mess. And
accomplish what if you took them to court?
But that's what I'm saying. An appearance ticket. I mean, some sort of a fine, something that they can be fined and held accountable. We always talk about people with noises and parties and all that stuff. I don't know. Look,
but people do that now. You know.
Exactly, and they get away with it. And that's
all the residents. I mean, Council Road and Park.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? They cleaned up the place now.
They did?
Yeah. Can you imagine this? But that's what we're talking about. I mean, it's always like that. Can't we? I don't know. It's just, there's got to be some. We as homeowners have to be held responsible as well. I mean, that's
You're
my
right.
theory. And there's nothing, an officer will come up and nothing they can do against us. So I don't know.
We also have to look at the increase in eviction rate, because landlord is going to say, okay, you strike one, I'm 3 points or 4 points, and I'm going to evict you, rather than waiting for 12 points. So we are going to look at the ways also that we open up here something, an avenue where a landlord can say, okay, I'm not going to tolerate zero tolerance, any noise nuisance or any problem, I will evict you. We're going to look at eviction down the road. It's like the court is, you know, full with eviction already, and here
yeah.
we are. You know, I support a program like this as a landlord. I support a program like this, but look, the consequences.
But if you already know there are calls to your property, then this doesn't apply to you. Do you know what I mean? If you know that your tenant has 3 points or whatever, it's because you know that the police have come to your property. This is for properties that the landlord isn't in touch with. So that's why it's that threshold, right, that doesn't even know the police are being called
to the property, doesn't even know the tenant is a problem tenant. So one of my things with this, the way it stands, is 12 months is way too long. I think we need to look at shortening that time period, because we have somebody in there for a year that is, you know, blasting music and having parties, and people are spilling out in the street drunk. And this is a real case scenario that I based the whole idea. I mean, these people just, it was, as I stood there with this man, you know, a kid came and loaded out all these bags of bottles into a shopping cart, and there were three or four people in and out, and music flaring, and people appeared in the street. That I didn't see.
So what, that was a homeowner? What if that was a homeowner? You had nothing to do then. You couldn't do anything against him.
It was a rental.
I know that.
I was standing talking to the homeowner that had nothing to do with that property. It was a rental property that a landlord owned.
I understand that, but what if that was the homeowner that was there?
Well, that I don't, I mean, other than giving them, that's a call for Mr. Falatico, but I don't think we can evict people.
No, no, Carl, could we, if you are the homeowner and you've gotten a certain number of points, could we make them pay for enforcement coming to their house, or some sort of, could we install some sort of fine?
We do fine people all the time for issues that come up at their house. You know, owner-occupied loud music, owner-occupied, anything, trash buildup. We bring people to court all the time. We want to work with everyone, but we prosecute cases. We use our discretion, and we move forward like that. Some of them, like you said, there are some that are more challenging, you know, based on the facts and circumstances of the particular case. You know, that one on Consol Road, dealt with them a number of times through the legal process. It always results in the problem getting fixed, and then a couple months later, the problem is back. So some nuts are tougher to crack like that. In terms of what you're saying, you know, charging the enforcement costs, there's a thing called the municipal cost recovery rule, which prohibits a municipality from recovering any of the costs for the services that we're required to provide, like police or fire. So we can't do that.
That's the union college law.
Actually, the original,
I thought that was the case, but I wanted to make sure.
Yeah, the original program that I found, which I think was in Milwaukee, they actually do pass the costs on to the property owner.
Right. But
that's not an option for us. And you know, in this case, I feel like there may be landlords that just don't know what is happening at their properties. You know, but anyway, Mr.
That's true. I can talk on behalf of that. That is true. The landlord who is not aware of what's happening, and there's no notification when you showed up there, it's like everything is good. And, you know, you mentioned about inspection. Is it going to be done by city staff after these complaints are filed, or the landlord are notified of these complaints that they allow city staff to inspect the apartment? What are you going to be inspecting?
It depends on what the situation is. What we have now, that's an example of one thing the city could do to aid a landlord if they requested it. So if they asked us and they gave us proof, enough proof that we had probable cause to believe that there was some violation in that property, then we could go and inspect the property.
Are you talking about an administrative fee attached to each visit?
No.
No?
If there's a violation, there's nothing to say the city can't write a violation for that. Again, that would be up to the...
So if I were to call you out, same situation here, if I were to call you out as a landlord and say, I'm having a problem with this tenant, you need to come and visit this apartment, that is a free, that's free of cost? No administrative fee for a city staff to go there and inspect an apartment to help in aiding the landlord in the eviction process?
There's nothing that says there would have to be a cost.
Okay.
Well, really something very different than what's being proposed here. It's not about landlords calling the city to
eviction. No. It's mentioned here that they will assist in the process, but if you're going to mention that, okay, the inspection process here, who is going to initiate the inspection process?
If an owner came and said, I'm having a problem, I would like the city to inspect my property because I want to get my tenant evicted, I think they're damaging the property, we could go about doing that. The city does that in situations now. Usually it happens when a tenant calls, and it usually results in a notice of violation, which does have a $50 administrative fee. It's possible that somebody could come in, and maybe the landlord would say, I want a certificate of occupancy, which I believe has a $25 fee for that, a certificate of occupancy. So we could go and do that inspection. Anything else is possible, too. That's not the overarching intent of the legislation, so I didn't flesh that part out too much, but if the council would like me to, I'd be happy.
Yeah, I would like, if you can touch on that part, to be very, very clear in terms of where the assistant comes in terms of landlord, city landlord. When you have to go visit the apartment, the city staff has to go visit the apartment, aiding the landlord to remove this tenant who's causing this problem. Is there any cost associated with that service?
And so I can look at that, but what we have to keep in mind is the city, you know, we have an anti-displacement policy. We've got other issues that come up where we can't just go and say, oh, I'm going to this property to try to aid the landlord. We can say we have information that says there might be an issue with this property, and the city can go and inspect and then proceed, you know, accordingly with that.
I just want to circle back, because what I'm talking about has nothing to do with the condition of the property. And if you're a landlord, I'm hoping that your property's up to code already. So that's kind of like a little bit, for me, it doesn't make sense to what that we're talking about. I understand us to be talking about is somebody who's constantly having parties, they're just constantly creating havoc in the neighborhood, in the building where they are. And those, we're trying to make sure that these kind of people aren't living in that particular property. And that the landlord is saying, I want to run a nice building, I have it up to code, everything is fine, but this person is dealing drugs in my apartment and having a lot of traffic, and that's what's happening. And I would like this person to be removed because they're bringing down the quality of life around people, not because my property's in disrepair, because I'm a good landlord and I'm keeping it up. But this person is bringing down the quality of life, not my property necessarily, but the quality of life here. So that is the case that I'm talking about, not that the property is a mess. Because, you know, I don't think that creates a whole other thing. If you're bringing the landlord in, if your landlord bringing you in, then code enforcement gets in there, oh yeah, fix that crack, do this, that, and then you could stay here because you're, you know, tenant, you could stay here, but landlord fix all that stuff. It creates a whole other situation. So that is not what I was speaking about. I was speaking about people who are being disruptive in the property.
The city can't really help with addiction, you know?
Well, if somebody, in drugs in particular, there's supposed to be some legislation in place where if there's constant drug dealing within a property, there's something that can be done about that.
Right, which would be the police going to the eviction hearing, yes?
Yes. And there's a certain provision in the penal law where if there's enough drug activity in a building that the DA's office can begin an eviction proceeding. But in your situation you lay out, somebody can come to the office and say, you know, they want to have a meeting, talk about their options, say that people are dealing drugs all the time. You know, I don't know how to prove it. And then we can tell them, well, you need to foil these documents. These are going to get you the incident reports that you can bring to court and get admitted, and then you can prove to the judge at the eviction hearing that the drug dealing is taking place and get the person out.
So Carl and I will work on massaging this a little bit more and bring it back in 2 weeks for consideration. We will take the feedback. Carl will also flesh out the assistance that the Corporation Counsel's Office can offer. And
did you ever? Scotia has something in their code. Did you ever look at that, or look at it?
I didn't. I will.
Yeah. I'll send it to you. I have it, because I looked at it like 2 or 3 years. I'll send it over to both of you. Maybe we can glean something off of what they have. It may not be perfect. It may not be any good at all, but.
Absolutely. Why not? Okay. Very good. Anything else to come before government operations this evening?
Will we adjourn?
Thank you. All those in favor? Aye. Adjourn. Thank you.
Okay, call to order Health and Recreation. The first thing, agenda item, is the award of a contract for fertilizer and turf supplies with Schenectady Muni Golf.
We have Nature's Fertilizer came today.
We did. It's a good thing the golf course was open last week and not today, like Troy's schedule. Nonetheless, each year we go out to bid for the necessary chemicals, the fertilizers, pesticides, and other supplies that are needed to keep the golf course in tip-top shape. We work with Mike Sesney, who's the superintendent of the course. He helps us put together the requirements, and we sent that out to bid this year. We had 8 respondents for the 37 items that were listed on the bid, And in reviewing those, we decided that there are six companies that meet specifications, and we'd like to recommend that the awards go as listed on the documentation that you have in front of you.
Questions, comments, concerns? Did you have a hand up, Ms. Brown?
No.
Mr. Minivera?
Just curious, bid number one. Am I seeing correctly, 4,200 versus the others are 31,531?
The extension, you mean?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sorry, yes. Mm-hmm. Bidder.
Extension. Some of these, you'll notice, bids are the same because what it is it's called an agency fee. So the manufacturer of that particular chemical states what it must be sold at. So regardless of which company is putting the bid forth, the price has to be the same on each of those chemicals. I see a look of puzzlement. I'm sorry. Did I not explain that correctly?
That's his normal look.
Other questions?
You're going to pretend that. So you're going to be, wow. So I said, no.
I'll entertain a motion.
Second.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's your first time. Is this the first time here? So you want to scare you off? You want to scare you off a little?
Yeah, yeah, all right. The next item on the agenda is the review of hours of operation for city parks. We had a public hearing on April. Public hearing is going on for April 11th. No action required. So did we? Was there any change in what we were putting forth?
The only thing is, and I send it to Carl. Believe it or not, somebody that was arrested for being in the park at dusk, I think in New York City, wasn't it, Carl?
Yes.
It's apropos, but the court found the ruling dusk is subjective, I guess. So I asked you if you could look at it way so we can tighten that up. What is dusk? Is it when you can't see without a light? Is that dusk? Because meteorological dusk may not be dark enough according to what the court says, right? So I don't know if you have any ideas to that when. If we discuss this after the public hearing.
Yeah, there's three different levels of twilight, depending on how many degrees the sun has gone below the horizon. 6 to 8.
It's kind of like when Easter is. With the
This is getting too long.
I'm sure that we will be able to deal with that in the legislation that we have to the clerk's office on Wednesday. It's good to keep in the back of our heads, but it will not be an issue.
Oh, goodness.
Good answer. So
bring your contractors.
All right. Is that it? Anything else regarding this, Ricky? Okay, so we'll be having a public hearing on April 11th. Okay, the next item is the discussion smoking ban around municipal buildings. Okay, so we had a presentation, I think, geez, I want to say it was, this was in December, was it that long ago? A while ago we had a presentation from the...
when it wasn't snowing.
when it wasn't snowing.
It must have been December.
So we're bringing this back again to, you know, just to see if we can move forward and get the legislation in place. You have a packet in front of you. The first one, it talks about the city of Schenectady tobacco-free workplace policy. But what we have been discussing, this starts on the second page, and that is actually smoking or non-smoking around municipal buildings. The Health and Recreation Committee had a meeting in February, and we discussed the legislation and talked about how being able to implement it within the city. One of the things that's not in the legislation, but that was discussed at our meeting and that we could, you know, the council can talk about is not only prohibiting use of tobacco around the buildings, but also in any city-owned vehicles. I am told that currently, even though there's a non-smoking policy within our vehicles, it's not being adhered to. So And I'm not sure how we then monitor that, but that was part of the discussion, and that we make sure that as we move forward with this legislation, we also include not smoking within in the city, any city-owned vehicle, period.
Put a smoke alarm in those new GPSs that we have.
That's a good idea.
Right to the source.
Welcome aboard.
Nice.
In addition to that, the another part of the discussion was, if you look at, actually these pages aren't numbered, but part of the legislation talks about the cigarette butts and what it causes, you know, the level of litter and pollution that it causes as a result of people smoking, throwing it out the window or throwing it on the ground or just getting rid of it in any way except putting it in an ashtray or a sand thing that people, that smokers use. And how we could, as we move forward with this, try to do some litter campaign around cigarette butts. But I think that considering the litter that we see all over the city, we could maybe be able to expand that a little bit further. So that was our level of discussion, and the members of the Health and Recreation Committee, are there other things that you wanted to add to that?
Yeah. You covered it.
So right now we'd like to be able to ask Mr. Calatico to take a look at the legislation and see about us implementing this around all municipal buildings, and I guess we would need to, obviously, we would need to discuss it with the mayor and which buildings when we say city-owned properties, city owns a lot of properties that are not necessarily municipal buildings, but my understanding of this is it's really basically around the municipal buildings that we would be wanting to implement this around. So.
City municipal buildings.
Unless you want the
county already has one.
The county has one?
So does the school district.
Okay. So these would be city municipal buildings that we would want to do this around and to put forward legislation. So Mr. Calatico, have you seen the legislation prior?
I have not reviewed what is inside of the packet tonight, mm-hmm. before today, so I would be happy to do that.
Okay. So, is there any other? Did anyone have any questions regarding that, or any input whatsoever in terms of that?
My only question was, what about municipal buildings in the city that aren't necessarily city? You answered that.
The city.
The county courthouse, the county building. We have the sheriff's office. You know.
And they already have their own.
They're 50 feet.
Bands. Yeah. They're 50.
Oh. 50 feet.
We're only 25 here at City Hall.
I know you are.
Well, I'm not sure that that's a tier two. That's my only thing. I mean, I think it's fine. I mean, personally, just walking through smoke, and back in the day, I smoked cigarettes, but walking through by people that smoke is very irritating to my asthma. But I just don't know how you police it. I just don't, you know, who, I've seen our city employees smoking. I just find that part of it to be challenging, you know. Doesn't mean you don't suggest it, you know, it's like our park, you know, I'm sure people smoke in our park still, even though you're not supposed to, but I guess it's
I've seen city employees do it.
In the park?
Yeah, and I get that we can't, you know, we're not going to, you know, have someone walking around and see a city employee, but I think that it's important that we post it in the car, no smoking, and then, I mean, it's going to be pretty clear when people have, because when don't we get our vehicles maintained and cleaned from time to time, you can tell when a vehicle's one that people smoke in all the time. It's
And do we still have funding, do we still have funding to have the signs made up you did in the county?
Yeah. There's plenty of funding for the signs. Mm-hmm. The smoking in the vehicles is against state law. Mm-hmm. The Clean Indoor Air Law in New York State says that there can be no smoking in a place of business. And so the city vehicles are places of business. Mm-hmm. So that's against state law.
Yeah, we want to strengthen this local legislation
to do that too. Yeah. And then the county doesn't, I don't think the county has any tobacco-free grounds policy.
Yes, we do.
Well, what I was talking about was 100% tobacco-free on county-owned property.
Oh, now that I know.
And many counties are doing that now.
Okay.
So that's why it would be easy to to monitor, because it would just be a yes or no. If you see someone smoking and they're on the property, that would be a yes in the policy.
So, Mr. Calatico?
Well, I will review this and have comments for the council whenever you'd like.
All right, 2 weeks. Okay, next, actually, Mr. Calatico, is your name is on the agenda for the review of the convenience store tobacco sales and advertising.
I know my name's on the agenda. I did not ask to have this. Well,
I don't know. I have a little
bit of
phone.
Oh, can
you put the camera on this side so we can see his facial expression again? Move the camera over here.
Yes. Okay, so there's been a variety of interesting faces.
This evening is very
interesting. So this one's address, was it last year?
Is it Sunrise? Yes. Yes.
It's one of those things that are just, they're hanging, it's hanging out there.
Yes.
You know, and we revisit it on occasion, and it just keeps hanging out there. So what I said to Mr. Valentico, because he said we just reviewed this a couple of months ago, I said, well, let's bring it to the table, decide what we're going to do with it, make a decision, and do whatever we're going to do, because it just kind of keeps hanging out there. So that's why. So it, Mr. Valentico just wants to review it. I mean, it's no cigarette sales within 1,000 feet of school, which does not count the businesses that are already in operation. And I'll let Mr. Valentico express his concern with.
Well, and he's reading a lot of
it.
It just as Council President laid out, would prohibit tobacco sales within 1,000 feet of school for any businesses that aren't there right now and properly licensed and are making 65% or more of their annual gross revenue from such sales. And the concern that I expressed to the Council before, you know, while this is completely legal legislation, is making sure that we are ready to enforce it correctly and we understand what the issue is going to be down the road. And one thing I remember we spoke about last time is some people on the council had concerns about, you know, a parent being able to pass their store down to a child, and when that change of ownership goes into effect, how does this legislation affect that? And I don't believe that we, you know, came to a resolution on that. There's also questions for when people are in situations like that, or maybe they only made 64% of their primary revenue sales from tobacco products. So they might not be grandfathered into something like this. How we identify them, and then do we compensate them for the loss of value of their business because they can no longer sell those tobacco products in that area if they argued that their business wasn't worth as much anymore to somebody who would be coming to buy it from them. That, on top of how we calculate the 1,000 feet and how we show the specific need in Schenectady for that 1,000 feet and how we came to it, because you have to have a rationale behind it. So it's something we can do. It's more than meets the eye from my perspective, but certainly it's up to the council and the mayor how we proceed at this point.
So, I mean, we're discussing it again. So your suggestion, when you say it more than meets the eye in terms of what the legislation says?
In terms of how we enforce the legislation.
How we enforce it. Enforce it. Well, I think that it would be a good legislation to have. Again, like you said, enforcing is one thing, and also, you know, when it's 1,000 feet at schools, daycares, and we have, daycares are like everywhere,
right.
You know, and people have them in their homes, so, you know, that becomes challenging in terms of
enforcing.
Yeah.
Because if they're not going that 1,001 feet to get it, they're going to go that 1,200 feet to get it. You know, they're going to go to the next store, you know. So, somewhat, yeah.
So, Mr. Felicico, don't want to put you on the spot. Can you come back with some recommendations of how we could approach this?
I can do so right now.
Okay.
My recommendation is that we don't do anything with this at this point in time.
Okay.
And you know, the council can continue to review it and maybe work with the mayor and see if they're you know, he would have to be part of whatever the enforcement mechanism of this is.
All right. So what I'm going to suggest is that the actually Health and Recreation Committee, we come together as a committee and discuss this and see if we can work with the mayor's office on that and follow through from there. Okay?
And you're talking about item number four?
Item number four. Okay.
Yes.
Are there other questions, concerns, comments?
Will we adjourn?
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned. Thank you.
So we're going to call for executive session first.
Do I need to call back to order?
Back to order the Committee on City Development and Planning. And I need a motion to go into executive session.
No, we need a motion. Oh, no. I'm sorry. Yes.
Correct. So moved. Mr. Montevarin, second by Ms. Porterfield. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
I didn't say that. No, I didn't.